I was triggered by the invitation to this conference. There is this gap between education and the current societal reality. It's still not quite clear to me whether the biggest gap is between education and the fourth industrial revolution or education and the sixth extinction, which one is more urgent. But anyway, this gap between how we thought about what were we thinking about education and what kind of thinking do we need today is what triggered me as I'm a philosopher of education. So the question is, what were we thinking? And then, you know, secondly, can we trust our own thinking to detect the errors in our own thinking? Or is that like the Baron of Munchausen pulling himself by his hair out of the morass? So maybe instead of thinking, we should think about or, you know, explore other ways of learning. So usually when I talk to learners, and they can be students or they can be higher education teachers, I start with a story that I learned from Jared Diamond about the Vikings that colonized about 1,000 years ago. They colonized Greenland. There was like a temporary mild climate and there were some green valleys. And there was a community of Inuit living there. They were hunter-gatherers and they had ice houses and they had, you know, warmed their houses and had light from the oil from the whales that they caught. So their technology and their economy was totally in line with the way they saw their own culture, and they lived there and they were very happy. And then the Vikings arrived and they started agriculture, not just hunter-gatherer, but agriculture. They built wooden houses, they even built churches and a very beautiful cathedral. They had ships that they could do international trade with to import glass. So then I usually ask the learners, who do you think has the most advanced system, the most advanced socio-economic system? Is it the Inuit or is it the Viking? And that helps them to reflect on, if they say the Viking, why do you say that? What is your implicit idea about advancement, human advancement, you know, education, emancipation? And so usually very interesting answers come up. You know, I give them the time to reflect, and all the answers are welcome. There's not a right and a wrong answer, because it's a complex story, of course. And then I finish with, you know, how does a story end? I show them that the Inuit, who were like totally within the living within the boundaries of that, like what you see here, you know, the biophysical processes at that part of the planet. So the Inuit were totally in harmony with that, both in their idea of what a good life is and in their economics and technology. Whereas the Viking considered themselves superior, more advanced, you know, superior identity. But after 450 years, they starved to death. And the very interesting thing is that they preferred to starve to death rather than give up their cultural identity and learn from the Inuit the more appropriate economic and technological means to live, to survive in that region. So then the question, of course, I ask the learners, like, why do I tell you this story? And they also come up with very interesting answers. The question is, of course, you know, are we any wiser than the Vikings? That is the big question. And then I show them this slide that was also shown by Carlos Alvarez Pereira. We are, you know, the bottom line is the Human Development Index. It's combining education, life expectancy, and income per capita. It's a combined metric. And you can see that this is how we have defined and organized human development. We have defined it in a way that does not take into account the reality of the planet, because on the left, the vertical axis, you see the number of planets we need to realize that kind of development. So we are totally in overshoot. And a part of that, of course, is that we organize health and education by taxing the economic growth. You know, the percentage of that goes to education. So we always will deplete, we have an extractive economic system, and part of it is redistributed for education and health. And what I learned yesterday is that health now today is more and more pressured also to contribute to the growth, to be commercial, etc. So here we have a perfect vicious circle. And then you can show that how that works. You know, are we any wiser than the Vikings? We are definitely also locked into this mental state that does not allow us to react to the sixth extinction and the climate change that is coming. We have defined economy in such a way or organized economy in such a way that the growth of the economy as a subsystem has become the goal. Prosperity is a goal in itself, and people and planet, you know, are resources, human resource or human capital and planetary resources. So because this growth model is incompatible with the real growth of the biophysical processes, the speed at which, you know, the solar energy and the materials can replenish the what we call the resources, you know, the biophysical processes, they get scarce, especially because we also use non-renewables a lot. So they get scarce, so there's a huge competition for these scarce materials. So people are getting more and more pushed to become competitive. You know, education has to make our children competitive. And it's a vicious circle. So it's really a race to the bottom, and we don't know if we're going to get out of that in time. And in the background of that, you know, Indo-European cultures, very, very old, we're talking centuries back, have this deep-rooted idea that man was created in the image of God as the culmination of creation. You know, we are above nature, we are not part of nature, we are above nature, and God has given nature to us as a resource to use for our whims. And scientists have kicked God out, but they hold on to this image that they can now rewrite the book of life. They're playing Homo Deus right now, and nature is still the resource for us to use. That is the deep, you know, the Viking consideration that we have. And the result is that we're like running an old car in a closed garage, because the CO2 in our planet is going nowhere. So if we stop the engine, we stop the car, like our current economic system will suffer, collapse, whatever, no jobs. If we don't stop this engine, we will also suffer and maybe, you know, go extinct. So with that, you know, we go back to it's a very complex and non-linear system. Like you saw the line of the Viking, it went up. They were very successful, and then all of a sudden it collapses. So this is like a tool that helps the learners to make sense of that, to map the complexity of our current society. You see autocatalysis or autopoiesis in the top, you know, Prigozhin, I hope. We are now evolving to the next level of complexity. We also have entropy. I'm not going into details there. We have the sun and the moon together with the minerals, etc., that together create an isolated system. There's, you know, first law of thermodynamics, nothing is coming in. We have what, you know, our patterns of making sense of life and death. How do we define a quality life, the good life? How do we define that? And then what means have we created to access the biophysical resources, you know, basis to fulfill that, what we have defined as our dream, as our vision of culture. And I call that ET because it's, you know, it's economic and technology. It's like the double helix, you know, they sort of like make this growth keep going. And I think that the very important ones and the ones that are often overlooked is the importance of the money system in here. And of course, the population size, you know, those are very often omitted from the systemic maps that we use. And this, and of course, then the you know, the human brain, the patterning instincts, you know, how are we wired so that all this goes together. And all the arrows show that these things interact with each other in nonlinear ways, in complex ways, etc. So this tool helps young people to say, if we say now, for example, we're going to change from non-renewable fossil fuel energy to, you know, keep that intact, you know, not change this and not change the model of growth. We're just going to change the technology from non-renewable to renewable. Is that compatible with the map? And then they can say no, because you're using scarce minerals. You're still, you're replacing one problem, the CO2, with another problem, you know, the entropy, the dissipation of the rare minerals that we need, you know, for the capture and the storage of the energy. So that helps them to detect what are real solutions. And I give them exercises, for example, explain how antibiotics, that was a fantastic innovation. So we thought, oh, I have an illness, I take a pill, I get healthy. So the more pills, the more health. And all of a sudden, non-linearity, antibiotics are the biggest problem ever. So they learn to work with this. And then, of course, after all this bad news, I come up with the good news, and I say that We have now the agenda to go back into that, you know, that bottom square is the SDGs. We're going to create human well-being within planetary boundaries. To do that, we're going to have to reinvent the ET from extraterrestrial economic and technology to technology and economics that are responsible and resilient in the Anthropocene. Terra means. And by peaceful cooperation and not economic warfare. So, you know, this is the same, the goals on the Anthropocene map. And then I also show them, very important, that we have now different lines. We still have the extractive growth line, which is like the Viking line that is collapsing. I mean, we don't know exactly when what will collapse. But I also show them that since 1972, the first report of the Club of Rome, I'm a little bit biased, you know, but okay, it's a beautiful symbolic date. There is a different, the light blue line is evolving. I've taken the turquoise, you know, as a second tire color. That is, you know, committed to bringing us back under the ceiling of the biophysical processes, and this is the SDGs, is the economic growth model that is in SDG 8. We'll have new economic technologies and economic models that help us to go back into the, you know, create human progress within planetary boundaries. And then I show them a lot of examples where that already happens. It's not the smart house, because that is not future-proof if you look at the Anthropocene map, but going back to biomimicry, like what Carlos also said, we can learn a lot from Africa, and this is happening. We have community land trust instead of, you know, speculation on ground. We have different building style, building techniques with local materials and local communities doing the work, community-supported agriculture, tool libraries, etc. And then, of course, we need the institutions to upscale that. You know, like the European Commons Assembly is the legal part. We have networks, we have education, training here. We have community currencies here. You know, all this, and this creates a virtuous circle for regenerative culture, for achieving all these, you know, these central goals for well-being, etc. And so the four, I hope I don't offend anybody with my terminology, I did not want to talk about the four pillars of education, because a pillar is dead and static and linear. I took placentas, I couldn't come up with anything better. This is, you know, give them hope, say this is happening, it's already happening, it's full of alternatives that do what Eric was saying this morning, this more functional economy is happening, it's out there, it's just under the radar of politics, economics, academia, press. We don't talk about it, but it's there, its emergence is there. And then we also have to give them, you know, the core values and stories about how important they are for our survival. Think of the Inuit. You know, they had their cultural identity and they were not unhappy. They were not feeling that they were not making any progress. They were happy, values. Then we also have embrace complexity, you know, learn that just this complexity is very creative. It's going to help us to move forward as long as, you know, we embrace complexity and non-linearity and do not expect to control where we're going to go. But like Donella Meadows said, swing the system. Learn to be adaptive and iterative research, etc. And of course, co-responsible learning. Nobody, you know, not our generation can teach the young people how to do it, but they have to be given the responsibility and, you know, the space where they can take the responsibility for their own future and co-create within the framework that we offer them. We're not saying, hey, we did it wrong, go and find something better. We are offering them frameworks like the SDGs and, you know, the Anthropocene map and the timelines. And that usually inspires them greatly. Thank you for your attention.